Thank you. That hasn't started yet, has it? The service. Mark came up to me right before I was walking up here, and he goes, I know you kept it at 52 in here so no one would fall asleep during your sermon. And so that's probably about accurate. But hey, good morning, First Christian Church. Glad that you're here. I know that it's cold. I know that it's cold in here. The furnace has been running all week, and it has not got above this temperature in here. So hopefully you saw my post on Facebook and said, dress warmly. Some of you did. Some of you did not. So you'll be awake. All right, so that is good, good, good. Hopefully when you walked in, you grabbed one of these that was in the back. This is our bulletin. You'll get to see the order of service that we have. If you look on the back, you get to see some of our announcements that we have. One is that there is a board meeting directly after the service this morning. So if you want to find out what's going on in the church, we have that, and it's going to be in the fellowship hall. So why don't we can meet there, and we'll talk about what's going on in the ministries. Also, Bible study and youth tonight at 6, that is now canceled, all right? So we are not going to be having that. And Mark, can you go close that door back there? I don't think we need to let the cold air out of here. So, all right, so no Bible study, no youth tonight. We're still going to determine, and no choir either. So all three are going to be canceled for tonight. So stay home, be warm, and stay protected. So that's what we're going to do tonight. We're going to cancel those. Also, next week, very, very special, very excited about the opportunity that we have as a congregation. Next Sunday during the service, we are going to have the ordination service for Robbie and Chris. So they're going to come forward. They asked what they're supposed to do. I said, you're going to kneel in front of the congregation. We'll pray of you. And they said, what if we can't get up after we've knelt in front of everybody? So we may just bring some chairs out for them to sit on. But that's going to be during the service next week. So make sure that you come for that. It's going to be a lot of fun and very exciting. And then, of course, that night or that afternoon at 4:30 in the fellowship hall, we're going to be watching Jesus Revolution. There is a donation for the food, so if you want to come and donate and help out with that, that would be amazing. So that is all the announcements that I have. Do me a favor, would you stand as we have our opening prayer? Father God, we come before you and we say thank you and praise you and bless you and honor you. And Father, when we come together like this as a family, and that's what we are. We're brothers and sisters in Christ. We come together as ones that just love one another and support one another and help one another. And Father, we get that from you. We get that because your love is supposed to be and is flowing through us so that we can have that love for one another. And so, Father, we thank you for this opportunity. We thank you for the chance to serve you in this capacity. Father, we also know that as we have these prayers and Father, we know that as we turn our hearts and our spirits to you and these prayers are lifted up to you, and we know, Father, that they will be a fragrant offering, and we're going to have the songs that we're going to sing. And of course, Father, in just a little while, we have the most important aspect of our church service. It's the time for us to take communion. And Father, when we take communion, it's time for us to look at ourselves and look at what you have done for us and what you have done by sending your son Jesus, who came and died on the cross for us, for the forgiveness of sins. And we praise your name. And we thank you for the message that we're going to have today. And we praise your name. Father, we know that this relationship that we have with you is crucial. We know that we can't survive. We can't live a life that is worthy of the call unless we have that relationship with you, and we also have that relationship with Jesus. Because who is he? He is our Messiah. He is the one who has come. He is the one who died for us so that we can honor you and glorify your name always. Thank you, Father, for all that you have done. Thank you for blessing us. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
He became sin, who knew no sin. that we might become His righteousness. He humbled Himself and carried the cross. Love so amazing.
Jesus Messiah, Lord of all. How fitting is that? I don't know if that is a sign of getting older, but I listened to a wise man and he says, if God speaks to you, get up, grab a pen and paper, write it down. So I don't know if that is evidential that I'm getting older or that I listen to a wise man. So it's up to you. But I took that advice and God spoke to me the last couple of weeks in so many ways, it was hard for me to understand. And this morning he gave me a dream, and I talked to Linda about it, and I was like, I don't get it. Until I picked up the scripture, what he gave me the same night, and it made sense. I want to read something from you out of 1 Corinthians 10th chapter, we started 31. So whatever you eat or drink or whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God. Do not cause any to stumble. Whatever Jews, Greeks, or the Church of God, even as I try to please everyone in every way, for I am not seeking my own good, but the good of many, so that they may be saved. Follow my example as I follow the example of Christ. And that was an eye-opener for me. Because when we take the communion in remembrance of what Jesus did, what he sacrificed, what he accomplished for us, our remembrance of Jesus, however, does not end with the communion. Our actions throughout the whole week, they should actually be as complacent as fixing our meals, what we have prepared for the day, or using the tools he gave us to do our job. You know, it is all about to honor Jesus. Whatever we do, never forget to honor him, because he did it all for us. So if you take the communion this morning, give him the honor for what he did for us. He set us free. He gave us the chance to mediate with our Heavenly Father directly. Take that in consideration when you pick up the next time a spoon, prepare food to give him the glory for it. Or when you fix a car, or when you go out feeding horses, or whatever you do, give him the praise and glory for it, because he made it possible for us to do those things. And when you read those words written right here on the table, let them be carved into your daily duties to remember what it's all about. Apply those words to your daily living, and you give him the glory and the honor he deserves. Heavenly Father, I thank you this morning for your Son, what he did for us, that he made it possible for us to be set free if we just invite him into our hearts and ask him to be our personal Savior. Father, I thank you for it, and I want to glorify you in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
Whether we're calling upon our Father to help us in our trials, praising Jesus Christ for being our Savior, or just worshiping God for who He is and all that He does. Psalms 113:2 says, "Blessed is the name from this day forth and forevermore."
Of abundance flow, blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the wilderness, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name.
Says, enter the sanctuary with lifted hands. Paul even told the church, men, pray everywhere with lifted holy hands. That just means you're supposed to worship the Lord with your mind, with your heart, with your body. We may be small in numbers, but when we worship the Lord, it's a blessing and it's meaningful.
that this world has to offer. The here and gone that leaves you wanting more, but can't satisfy. Father, forgive me for taking so long to see that you're all I need. With every to deserve it. You see the best in me beneath the dust, 'cause that's how you love. Yeah, that's how you love. You rush through my veins. I'm wrecked and I'm changed, and my soul
by day, and with each passing moment, strength I find to meet my trials here, trusting in my Father's wise bestowment. I've no cause for worry or for fear. He whose heart is kind beyond all measure gives unto each day what he deems best. Loving me, it's part of pain and pleasure, mingling toil with peace and Himself is near me with the special mercy for each other. All my cares he fain would bear and cheer me. He whose name is Counselor and Power, the protection of his child and treasure, is a charge that on himself he laid. As thy days, thy strength shall be in measure. This the pledge to me he made. Help me then in every tribulation, so to trust thy promises, O faith, sweet consolation, offer me within thy holy word. Help me, Lord, when toil and trouble meet thee, e'er to take as from a father's hand, one by one.
Well, I got a text message from Samantha this morning at 7:30 and said, hey, the worship area, the sanctuary is going to be cold. It's 53 in there right now. Or I don't know what the temperature is, but I was like, okay, that's chilly. So I made sure, she goes, make sure you put that out on your post about your picture. And I said, okay. And so I did. And then I said, if it's going to be chilly in there, I need to wear a sweater. And then I had to ask myself, do I own any sweaters? Because I haven't worn a sweater since I moved here over 5 years ago. And I'm like, where? And I look in my closet, and there on a shelf above, I was like, there's a sweater. So I jumped up, grabbed it, and I said, does it even fit? Because I didn't know. I mean, I haven't worn it for so many years, and I do. It fits. And I'm like, and it's kind of nice. It feels good in here with the sweater. And I hope you think it feels good in here too. But yeah, it feels good. Everybody's asking me about my pipes. Because they froze. Again. And so everyone's like, hey, how's your pipes? How's your pipes? Well, I didn't have water downstairs for about 3 days, maybe four. And but they had water upstairs. And someone asked, well, why didn't you go upstairs and take a shower and in the bathroom in Cameron's room or in Jordan's room? Well, I'll take a shower in Cameron's room because she's a girl and she's going to keep it halfway clean. I am never taking a shower in my son's bathroom the entire time he's going to live with us because I think I would leave that bathroom dirtier than I was when I went in. But so they came the other day and they fixed the pipes. So they got out there and they got them all working. I had two busted pipes underneath the house, and they started working, and they turned the key, and the water started flowing, and then water came rushing out from underneath my dishwasher. And so I was like, oh, no. And so I ran to the front door and said, well, Robbie was calling me at that time. And so I answered. I said, I can't talk. And then I hung up. And then I ran to the front door and said, turn it off, turn it off. He ran back over and he turned it off. And he goes, what? And he came in and I had to grab some towels. So the water line going from the cold into the dishwasher froze. And the connection on the bottom of the dishwasher, it cracked. So now, and I said, okay, so now I don't have a dishwasher. And I said, that's okay. I can hand wash dishes. I know how to do that. I'm okay with this. So I told Jordan, hey, da-da-da. Well, I forgot to tell him Thursday to keep the water dripping in the kitchen. So he came home from work, turned off the faucet, and went to bed. So I woke up the next morning, pipes frozen again in the kitchen. So today, hopefully if it's warm enough, I'm going to find out if I have any more broken pipes underneath the house. Say a prayer for me. All right, say a prayer for me. All right. Turn in your Bibles to Luke chapter 3. Luke chapter 3, starting in verse 1. All right. We're all there? Here it says this. In the 15th year of the reign of Tiberius Caesar, when Pontius Pilate was governor of Judea, Herod, tetrarch of Galilee, his brother Philip, tetrarch of Iturea and Trachonitis, Lysanias, tetrarch of Abilene, during the high priesthood of Annas and Caiaphas, the word of God came to John, the son of Zechariah, in the wilderness. That's a mouthful, isn't it? All right. He went into the country around the Jordan, preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. As it is written in the book of the words of Isaiah the prophet, a voice of one calling into the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord, make straight the paths for him. Every valley shall be filled in, every mountain and hill made low. The crooked road shall become straight, the rough way smooth, and all the people will see God's salvation. John said to the crowds coming out to be baptized by him, you brood of vipers, who warned you to flee the coming wrath? Produce fruit in keeping with repentance, and do not begin to say to yourselves, we have Abraham on our side. For I tell you that out of the stones God can raise up children for Abraham. The axe is already at the root of the trees, and every tree that does not produce good fruit will be cut down and thrown into the fire. So stop right there. See, there was something that God had to prepare for the people. And the thing that he had to prepare for the people was not only was Jesus going to be coming, but he had to prepare the people for Jesus to come. And that is why John the Baptist was able to come. He was the one that was going to go and prepare the way for the people to know who Jesus is. See, he had to have that set in stone and going in the order so that John can say these things, prepare people for Jesus. He was able to show them the way that they had to go in order for them to see who Jesus is, and they had to be able to make sure that the people knew the truth. And Isaiah was showing the way of John. What does that relate to us? See, God had a plan set for John. You need to do this to show people who Jesus is. And there are so many times we have the same thing. We are put in a position, we're put in place so that we are able to talk with people, share with people, love on people so they are able to see who Jesus is. But here's the problem. We're too afraid to. We're too afraid to talk. We're too afraid to share with people. We're too afraid to say the truth to some people. Therefore, we don't talk to them about Jesus. We don't talk to them about the things that we're supposed to. There's a huge wave that seems to be flowing through Christianity right now that we've got to stop. Because we're afraid to talk to people. Maybe we don't have all the right words. Maybe we don't have all the biblical knowledge that we're supposed to have in order we think that we have to be able to have to be able to talk to people. But all we can say is, I'm hoping that I don't offend anybody. Sounds simple? I don't want to talk to someone because I might say something that's going to offend them. I don't want to talk to someone and share with them about who Jesus is or things that they need to change in their life because I might accidentally offend them. And so we go around in life and we keep looking for all these little ways out so we don't say the hard things. We don't say the difficult things. And we start going through life and we say this or say that, but we don't want to offend anybody because we're afraid that if I offend them, then they're not going to listen to me. But sometimes we have to offend people in order for them to see who Jesus is. So we've got to be able to say and be confident in the things that we know that we're supposed to. John the Baptist was. Yeah, but that's John the Baptist. Yeah, I see that and I get that. It's John the Baptist. That was what he was supposed to do. That's what we're supposed to do. We're supposed to prepare the way for people too so that they see who Jesus is. What kind of conversations did John have with the people who were around? Well, we already saw this. Hey, you brood of vipers. Hey, you people, you think you're doing the right things, but you're not. The people that you think you're living the right way, but you're not. The people who think you know all these things, but you're not living the right way. And God is coming, and he's going to take an axe, and he's going to chop you down because you're not producing fruit. You heard me preach about that from my first sermon here, John chapter 15. You've got to produce good fruit, or he's going to chop you down. And the only way to produce good fruit is to do the things that he wants you to do, which is share, talk, be an example, love on the people around you. That's when you start bearing good fruit, you brood of vipers. What else does he say? He says this. Look at verse 10. What should we do then? The crowd asked. Hey, what do we do? All right, you say we're going to get chopped, we're going to get thrown into the fire. You think, you know, we're not producing good fruit. So what do we do? All they're going to do is ask you simple little questions about what they need to do. You don't have to go into some big elaborate story about anything. You just tell them the truth. What do we do? Oh, okay. Verse 11, John answered, anyone who has two shirts should share with the one who has none, and anyone who has food should do the same. Hey, this is simple. You see someone in need? Help them. Help them. You got two shirts? You don't need two shirts. You only need one. Help them. You got food? You see someone who's hungry? Give them food. Help them. It's simple. It's simple. What do? Help them. All right, what else do we do? All right, what else are we supposed to do? Even tax collectors came to be baptized. Teacher, they asked, what should we do? Verse 13, don't collect any more than you were required to, he told them. Don't collect any more than you need. Because what were they doing? They were lying in their pockets. Don't collect any more than you're supposed to. And it was well known that they were doing this. Don't do it. Hey, now that we're changing our ways, now that we're living a life that's differently, and we got baptized, what are we supposed to do now? Don't collect more than you should. Simple, to the point. Then there's also this. Then some soldiers asked him, and what should we do? And he replied, don't extort money and don't accuse people falsely. Be content with your pay. What do I do? What do I do? What do I do? What should I do? You know these people well enough. If they're coming up to you and talking to you about things, what do I do? Tell them. Stop doing this. But I don't want to offend anyone. I don't want to hurt their feelings by telling them this. I don't want them to, if I tell them this, I might actually push them away, or you might actually get them to be closer to who Jesus is instead. You don't have to have all this biblical knowledge to be able to tell people the truth. But tell them the truth. What do? Stop. Help them. Make sense? All right. Makes sense. Good. Everybody's head was nodding. Not. It's too cold in here. I know. I saw. Yeah, you were. All right. Then the people were waiting expectantly and were all wondering in their hearts if John might possibly be the Messiah. John answered them all, I baptize you with water, but the one who is more powerful than I will come, and the straps of whose sandals I'm not even worthy to untie. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fork is at the hand of the cleared the threshing floor and to gather the wheat into his barn. But he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire. And with this many other words, John exhorted the people and proclaimed the good news to them. Hey, I'm not the Messiah, but there's one who's coming, and he's going to burn up the chaff. He's going to burn up the stuff that's not really any good, and his winnowing fork is there on the threshing floor. And so, hey, just be prepared, because the one who I'm telling you about, the one I'm baptizing for and preparing the way for, he's coming to clear house. Make sure that you're ready. And we do see that all the time in the news or on Facebook and everything, that Jesus is going to come at any minute now. Yeah, he is. And when he comes, he's going to clean house. He's going to clean house. He's going to burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire. Got to be ready. And when John rebuked Herod, the tetrarch, because of his marriage to Herodias, his brother's wife, and all the evil things he had done, Herod added this to them all. He locked John up in prison. When all the people were being baptized, Jesus was baptizing too. And as he was praying, heaven was open, and the Holy Spirit descended on him in bodily form like a dove. And a voice from heaven, "You are my son, whom I love. With you I am well pleased." Now Jesus himself was about his 30 years old when he began his ministry. He was the son, or so it was thought, of Joseph. Ready for this? Read along. Ready? Eric, are you ready? Yeah, I'm ready. The son of Heli, the son of Mathat, the son of Levi, the son of Melchi, the son of Janai, the son of Joseph, the son of Matthias, the son of Amos, the son of Nahum, the son of Esli, the son of Nagai, the son of Math, the son of Matthias, the son of Simeon, the son of Jozak, the son of Jodah, the son of Jonan, the son of Russia, the son of Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, the son of Neri, the son of Melchi, the son of Adi, the son of Kasem, the son of Elmadam, the son of the son of Joshua, the son of Eleazar, the son of Joram, the son of Mathat, the son of Levi, the son of Simeon, the son of Judah, the son of Joseph, the son of Jonam, the son of Elikam, the son of Meleah, the son of Menah, the son of Mathatha, the son of Nathan, the son of David, the son of Jesse, the son of Obed, the son of Boaz, the son of Salmon, and the son of Nashon, the son of Amadad, the son of Ram, the son of Hezron, the son of Perez, the son of Judah, the son of Jacob, the son of Isaac, the son of Abraham, and the son of Terah, the son of Nahor, the son of Serug, the son of Ruah, the son of Peleg, the son of Eber, the son of Shelah, the son of Canaan, the son of Arphaxad, the son of Shem, the son of Noah, the son of Lamech, the son of Methuselah, the son of Enoch, the son of Jared, the son of Mahalalel, the son of Kenan, the son of Enosh, the son of Seth, the son of Adam, the son of God. Why is that important? Why do you think it was important to be put in this book after all the things that we just read about Jesus, after all the things that we read about him coming and Isaiah telling about John and preparing the way, and then you had to go through and you had to look at the lineage of who Jesus is, because you have the second Adam, which is Jesus, and you have to know that the lineage goes all the way back to the original Adam. And the Savior had to come from the original Adam. So what was Luke trying to accomplish here? Luke was trying to accomplish, hey, you know all those Jewish papers that we have in the temple that have the lineage of all of the Jewish families? This is where Jesus is in all this. This is where he comes from. You wonder who this Messiah is going to come from? John. You didn't see John the Baptist's name in there, did you? No, because he wasn't in that lineage. He was cousin. He was, you know, it wasn't him. Oh, it's not me. It's the guy that's coming after me. It's not me. It's this guy who's coming here to prepare the way. And guess what? After the Romans destroyed the temple, all of that is gone. There's no way to trace back the lineage of Jesus or the other Messiah going all the way back to Adam. It's all gone. They can't do it. Then it goes on and says this. Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, chapter 4, left the Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. He ate nothing during those days, and at the end of them he was hungry. And the devil said to him, if you are the Son of God, tell this stone to become bread. And here's the thing about the devil. He knew who Jesus was. But he still was egging him on just a little bit there. Hey, if you really are the Son of God, you just tell this rock to become bread. You just cause it to come into existence. And if you really are the Son of God, you can do this. And Jesus, of course, is looking at him going, no. Because look at verse 4. Jesus answered, it is written, man shall not live on bread alone. And of course, we all know that sometimes when we're just going through those hardships, and you've been taught this your entire life, if you've gone to church, when you are being tempted by the Satan, when you're being tempted by the demons or the devil or whatever the case may be, you use scripture to counter, and that is exactly right. But I don't know the scriptures. Man, you've got more power in you than you actually think you do. All you got to do is rebuke. Get away from me. I know better than this. How do you know better than this? Because someone in the very beginning told you the difference between right and wrong. Someone in the very beginning was able to come to you and tell you, hey, stop doing this, because you know that's not the right thing to do. You know you're supposed to help someone who's in need. Why? Because we just read, hey, if you have two shirts, give one to someone who doesn't. If you have more food, give it to someone else. Yeah, but what else do I need to do? Stop taking more than you need. Someone had to tell you that. So when you are being tempted to take more than what you're supposed to, or exhort or extort money from people or do whatever the case may be, you know someone had to tell you to stop doing those things. And we have all this right here in the scriptures. So when you are tempted, when you are tested, you've got all this battle power right here in front of you to help you defeat it. Okay. Hey, if you are, man does not eat on bread alone. Verse 5, then the devil led him up to a high place and showed him in the distance all the kingdoms of the world. And he said to him, I will give you all of the authority and splendor. It has been given to me, and I will give it to anyone I want to. If you will just worship me, it will all be yours. And Jesus answered, it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only. And the devil led him to Jerusalem and had him stand on the highest point in the temple. If you are the Son of God, he said, throw yourself down from here. For it is written, he will command his angels concerning you to guard you carefully. They will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone. And Jesus answered, it is said, do not put the Lord your God to the test. And when the devil had finished all this tempting, and he left him until an opportune time. Jesus returned to Galilee in the power of the Holy Spirit, and news about him spread through the whole countryside. He was teaching in their synagogues, and everyone praised him. He went to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, and on the Sabbath day he went into the synagogue, as was his custom. He stood up and read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was handed to him. Unrolling it, he found the place where it is written, the Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to proclaim the good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for your prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. Then he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. The eyes of everyone in the synagogue was fastened on him. He began by saying to them, today the scripture is fulfilled in your hearing. All spoke well of him and were amazed at the gracious words that came from his lips. Isn't this Joseph's son? They asked. Aren't we afraid of that point too? Going back to the very beginning, when we're teaching people or sharing with people, loving on them, helping them, pointing out and wanting them to see the truth, and we're telling them the things that they're doing wrong or whatever the case may be, and we're all afraid they're going to look at us and say the same thing. Yeah. Who are you to tell me this? Who are you to correct me? Who are you? Who do you think you are? You think you're better than me, don't you? You think you know more than me, don't you? You think this and that, and they'll throw everything out at you. But we're afraid they're going to do that. We're afraid they're going to say something to hurt our feelings or whatever the case may be. But I would rather them say something to hurt my feelings than not say something to them about their life. Because we will be judged for this. Every single one of us. He's going to look at you and say, why didn't you talk to that person? Yeah, but I didn't want to say something to offend them. Why didn't you say this to those people? Yeah, I didn't want to hurt their feelings. Why didn't you say this to those people? Yeah, but you know what they might say about me instead? What if they'd say, wait a minute, who do you think you are? Didn't you grow up here in Nazareth? Is it your father Joseph? Who do you think you are? Aren't you this guy from up north? But you don't know me down here in the South. You don't know these things. Don't you know these things? Yeah. Well, who do you think you are? I'm his son. I don't have all the answers, but he does. I may not have all the words to say, but he'll give you the words to say. All you have to do is say them. You don't have to be a biblical scholar to be able to do this. All you got to do is do it. Does that make sense? With a lack of nodding, I think everybody agrees. All right. You just got to take the chance. You have to be prepared, though, because people are going to say things. People are going to make fun of you. People are going to hurt your feelings. But you got to be prepared. Don't let the way of this world change the way that you do things. Just do it. All right? Our song of invitation that we have is Sweet Hour of Prayer. And we're going to go ahead and stand as we sing the song Sweet Hour of Prayer. If you need prayer, if you need anything, come down and see me. I'd be happy to talk to you. Please stand as we sing Sweet Hour of Prayer. Sheridan came down, obviously, and everybody saw that, and you know, I leaned in, and she just said, I just need prayer. Perfect. All right. So would we close in prayer, and we'll pray for Sheridan as well. So, Father, thank you so much for all that you do for us. Thank you for blessing us. And we know, Father, that as we go through life, and we know that it's never going to be an easy road because you never promised us that it was going to be easy. But, Father, when we come to you and trust in you and believe in you and follow you wholeheartedly, Father, we know that you're going to take care of us in every single way. And Father, it's a blessing to be able to have that and do that. Father, I thank you for Sheridan and the courage that it takes to come on down and just say, hey, I need prayer. And so, Father, we ask that you go and just be with her and strengthen her and help her, you know, deal with whatever it is that she's dealing with or struggling with, whatever she's struggling with. And Father, we just lift her up in prayer to you and say, Father, just strengthen her. Help her through this hardship. Help her through the great time, whatever the case may be. And Father, we know that you're there. We know that you're going to support her and love on her and be with her because we come before your throne and we're asking this. Father, I thank you so much for this congregation. I thank you for the chance to serve you and to honor you the way that we do. Father, all of life is about you and to seek after you and be counted as yours. And we are blessed to be able to do that. Thank you, Father, for the time that we've had, and we pray, Father, that everything that we have done is for your glory. Thank you for loving us, and thank you for sending your son, Jesus, who died on the cross for us. And it's in his name that we pray. Amen.